Welcome to the jurisprudence. This is lesson number 7. Under this lesson, we are going to talk about another very interesting period, the period known as Illuminism period, Enlightenment period, the period that starts with the great reforms, or the period of Martin Luther. This is the period that is characterized with enlightenment, with studies, with metaphysics, with the medieval philosophy of the Germans, of the French, of the Italians, but also of the English people or the British. This period of time is very interesting, as I had said before. It is the period of scholasticism, the scholars. People were engaged in writing treatises and also engaged in critiquing such treatises. And that is what has developed into what we today know as the general jurisprudence. In this case, we attribute this period to the following: a German philosopher by the name Immanuel Kant. Immanuel Kant is the one who came up with the pure critique of reason, or critique of pure reason, in which he comes up with his categorical imperative theory. Under this, he explains his moral philosophy by looking at human conscience, and our human conscience is working as a judge, as a machine, or as a court, in which the judge there is the conscience that judges our human acts, good acts versus the bad acts. Whereas the good acts are to be followed through a certain kind of motivation or to be pursued. The bad acts are to be avoided. This is prompting us into another language of the dimension which we had already seen in the Greek philosophy, in which there is pleasure versus pain. Pleasure is to be pursued. Pain is to be avoided at all cost. In this case, Immanuel Kant is the founder of deontology. Deontology, or deo, is duty. Logia is the study. It's the study of duty. Duty-based actions. Deontology is about the imperatives, that law is order, and order is duty. We are under duty to act, or we are not under duty to act. So in this case, he talks about the question of the means, saying that means at the end, saying that the action can be the means to an end, and the means to an end is what matters. That means the means justify the end, that the end means the consequences. So whatever one does as the means is what matters, and that is the duty, and that's the deontology. But the consequences of that action does not matter, because that is another thing known as teleology. So teleologists like Aristotle were pointing at the good action that will generate the good consequence. But the consequence is superior to the action or to the means. Kant is opposed to this. Kant is saying the means matter before the consequences. The teleologist, Aristotelians, argue that the consequence or the end matters. So whatever we do in our earthly life, provide that we will achieve the best outcome, it is good. That is, the end justifies the means. As long as the end is good, the means doesn't matter. whether you have to steal in order to obtain the good, that is the wealth, then you are just okay. But deontologists argue differently, that as long as the action is bad, it doesn't matter what would be the consequence. In this case, it is the means justifying the consequence. The means may be bad. For instance, maybe there is a crowd of people in thousands, and somebody has walked in with a machine gun, maybe a terrorist, who is going to eliminate all of them at once. And in that case, you move in and kill this person before he kills many people. Maybe he has only killed two and was supposed to eliminate all of them. And you finish him. According to Kant, you have acted imperatively and under duty. You are under categorical duty to carry out that exercise. But the end is bad because you have also committed a crime and you should also be prosecuted. But according to Kant, this is justified. This is justified. Kant also said that man is not a means to an end. Man is an end in himself. And he was giving value to the individualism. There, our individual right begins with Immanuel Kant and a French philosopher, René Descartes, almost contemporaries, but Descartes comes before Immanuel Kant with his philosophy that has been defined as the philosophy of thinking. I know that I am thinking. My knowledge is only backed by the fact that I'm aware that I am carrying out an activity, that is the thinking. I am because I'm thinking. Je pense donc je suis. Cogito ergo sum. Our being is defined only by one fact, our thinking capacity as individuals. Whether Descartes was aware that some people may have faulty thinking or defective thinking capacity, that doesn't matter. But what he was aware of is that his being is backed by this individualistic right of thinking. And that's what brings the awareness. And that is what builds into the knowledge. All this kind of knowledge takes us to the English jurists and philosophers who introduced the empirical approach to the metaphysics. And this is David Hume, a Scot philosopher who wrote about the nature of man or human nature. He wrote about the five senses, but also the common sense. Hume is exposing to us the knowledge that is based on our human experience. Knowledge is what we experience, what we can experiment, what we can take to the laboratory and experiment, then make the inferences. This is what we call the positive method or the scientific method or empirical method or the approach that is backed by scientific knowledge of things. This is very interesting indeed, because this is what gears us towards the analytical jurisprudence and also the legal positivism, in which what we know as truth is what we can experiment, what we can experience through our senses, and what we can go through as our personal experiences. Hume was very interesting, but Hume opens the way to other positive philosophers such as Jerome Bentham. But this is in antecedence with the thinking of Thomas Hobbes prior to David Hume. the thinking of John Locke, Berkeley, George Berkeley. And all this happens in the British Isle. And this is again what helps us to engage with the other aspect of the jurisprudence that we are going to see under the modernism, the postmodernism period. In this time, we see that legal positivism emerges in full swing, the questioning of law as it is, and rejecting law as it ought to be, and jurists and scholars getting divided along the natural law theory and along the positivist law theory, in which legal positivism is making us understand the law and study the law. This is for the first time I'm talking about the study of the law within the jurisprudence. Remember, we started by talking about the jurisprudence without mentioning the study of the law, because the study of law as discipline was introduced by Professor Jeremy Bentham of the 19th century and his pupils such as John Austin and others became even stronger in making more contribution to his thinking. Jeremy Bentham wrote about the province of law, how to build the scientific approach and using the knowledge of law, making reference to the scientific methods and the scientific conception and the way of understanding things. So what is the truth is what is knowable through scientific methods or the empirical evidence and empirical methods. This is very important indeed, and it brings us to the question of law, looking at the validity, not the morality of law. The morality is concerned with the good versus the bad, the right versus the wrong, or the right versus the evil. And in this case, the validity does not have any clue about that approach, because the validity of law relies mostly on the dexterity, on the procedures and the processes. If the procedures and processes followed to come up with the law are right and good, that means that that law is right and good. They are not bothered about the just and unjust law. That is the contradiction they have with the naturalist law theorist, because the naturalist would look at the law as it ought to be, not law as it is. Thank you for watching. This is helping us to engage with the jurisprudence, what we know as the jurisprudentia generalis. Bye, and thank you for being here.